You left one. There is something about this story of Bartimaeus. It's, with all the actions that are happening, I feel like I could just see it. And not only in the context of the biblical setting, but even here today, right? They're on the road from Jericho toward Jerusalem. It could be the I-95 corridor. On those crowded city streets, think of downtown Boston or New York City, right? People are in a rush to get to work, and they talk on their cell phones with their heads down. And here and there, there's someone sitting on the side of the road with a cardboard sign or holding out a dilapidated Starbucks cup and asking for change. Messengers on bikes fly past, and interns balance trays of coffee, and tourists walk slowly, unfolding maps and looking around self-consciously. Jesus and the disciples walk along, talking to one another. They cross the street without looking both ways, just following the crowd, when all of a sudden Jesus hears someone call out his name, and he stops. And the woman who's walking behind Jesus runs into him and spills her coffee everywhere because she was texting and not paying attention. And the nanny with the stroller behind her makes a big deal of how very inconvenient it is to go all the way around the spilled coffee mess. And a group of businessmen pass Jesus on the other side and give him a dirty look and mutter, "Tourists." But Jesus takes no notice of any of this. He just stands still and calls out to the man, "What do you want me to do for you?" Stopping like that, standing still in our lives that are built on constant motion, it can be dangerous, to say the least. Now, the title of this morning's sermon is taken from the words of one of the great poets of our time, the rapper Vanilla Ice, who calls us to stop, collaborate, and listen. Joking aside, though, isn't that really what we've been talking about for 3 weeks now? How in order to heal from pain and suffering, we need to press pause on the ways we've been avoiding and denying it? The urgent importance of listening to each other, of attending to one another's pain, and collaborating, trusting in the transformational power of God's community to heal one another, to transform one another, to bring hope. And so, let's stop, collaborate, and listen to what's happening in today's gospel reading. In case you didn't get it from watching the actors or from the way I retold the story, everything hinges on this one moment, I think, this time when Jesus stops. Bartimaeus is healed, and this moment marks a major turning point in Jesus' life as well. For example, do you remember what Jesus called out, what Bartimaeus called out to Jesus? Do you remember what he said? on the very next page after this story, Jesus will enter Jerusalem in the spectacle of Palm Sunday and the beginning of the end of his human life. Jesus' encounter with Bartimaeus calls us to pay attention to who Jesus is and what he has come to do. Now, Jesus also allows Bartimaeus to follow him on the way. Now, before the story in the book of Mark, everyone else who Jesus has healed, you remember what he tells them? He says, go home. Go home. Don't follow me. And even this time, Jesus says, go. Your faith has healed you. But Bartimaeus does not go. He follows. Jesus doesn't seem to mind this time. Maybe he knows he's going to need all the support that he can get from this point out. The difference between what happens before and after Jesus stops and turns toward Bartimaeus, it's life-changing, both for a blind man who can suddenly see and for a roving rabbi who is about to act for the salvation of all the world. And it all begins with the stop. But that's not all, right? This transformation also requires listening. Even though the crowd was trying their hardest to shush him, good acting crowd, even though Jesus and the disciples were already on the road and went to somewhere else, they could have even been late, Jesus listened, at least enough to hear Bartimaeus as he shouted out louder. And as much as we are unaccustomed to stopping, we are also not used to listening. This week I found myself, horror of all horrors, standing in a line without my smartphone. Here I was, a good 5 to 7 minutes out from placing my order with no distractions. My skin began to crawl, my stomach clenched. How was I going to endure this with nothing to watch, nothing to swipe, no candy to crush, or emails to answer? And so, of course, my mind began to swim with all the things I could have been doing for these 5 minutes that I was not doing. I could have returned those emails, I could have texted that person, I could have made that grocery list, what you do and how you care for one another. Take heart. Jesus is calling you. They are words that we can give as we reflect one another the gifts and the callings that we see in each other's lives. They are words of hope. They are the stuff of miracles. Dangerous and uncomfortable as it may be, if we can stop and listen and come together, we may just hear Jesus' next words to us. What do you want me to do for you? This past week, hopefully, you received the first letter of our stewardship season. Because 3 weeks of sermons on pain and suffering went over so well, I thought, maybe it's time for a sermon about money. Seriously, though, I don't know about you, but money is another one of those things I'm afraid to stop and look and listen about. My relationship with money most urgent bills to be paid, of the stomach-turning realization that that was late or that there's not enough, of the Sisyphean task of digging out of debt only to be piled back on, I often spend my money with fear or anxiety or without thinking about it at all in order to avoid all of those negative feelings. I'm willing to bet that rich or poor, everybody here approaches money with some apprehension or would just avoid the thoughts about it altogether. In the same way that we sometimes need to put down our smartphones, what if we stopped and sat down and made a plan with intention about how we wanted to spend our money? What if we mindfully decided what we wanted to do and support with purpose? What if we made a plan for getting out of debt and stuck to it? What if we listened to what God is calling us to do, regarding our material wealth not as a problem, not as a possession, but as belonging to God? I don't know. Maybe a miracle would happen. Stop, collaborate, and listen. It's as poetic a stewardship tagline as I've ever heard. And even though the press of busyness, the fear of what lies in wait for us is always there, Jesus, too, is always there. Just stopped in the middle of that busy street, holding a place of rest for us. Jesus is always ready to hear our cries and to stand still for us as long as we need. And if we can listen, take heart, friends, he is calling you. Jesus is calling the church to the work of God's kingdom in the world, and together we are doing it. Together with one another, with God, we are transforming dollar bills into community. Mourning into joy, loneliness into relationship, isolation into connection. It is miraculous and it is happening. And Jesus is here, standing still in the middle of it all and calling, "What do you want me to do for you?" Friends, what do we want Jesus to do for us?